Welcome to the BioBalance Healthcast, episode number 467. Arimidex can help recreate a youthful hormone balance in men. BioBalance Health features conversations about anti-aging medicine. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health, and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about testosterone replacement therapy for women, and Got Testosterone, the newly released book for men that helps men choose the most effective and safe form of T replacement. These books are available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health in St. Louis and in Kansas City. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients. So, as we get older, heart attacks become more and more of a concern for many of us, both men and women. And that's a sort of a new thing because we're learning that women have different symptoms that tell us they're at risk to have a heart attack. And the death rates for women with heart attacks have been increasing because we've been treating them like men.
Right. When they come in the ER, they don't have the same symptoms as men, so they go, oh go home.
Yeah, see ya. You have indigestion.
Yeah. And then they go home and die. And so that's a problem. So
So there's some discussion about the role that estrogen and the amount of estrogen that we have in our bodies, both men and women, plays in increasing the risk of heart attacks that we have.
So we used to think estrogen was bad, that it would cause heart attacks. We now know that that's only a small portion of the population, and it is only related to oral estrogen replacement like Premarin. So we're not talking about the estrogen you make yourself or estrogen that is bioidentical and non-oral. We're talking about one type of estrogen that has a bad rap.
To make sure that I understand, the bad rap for estrogen is more associated with breast cancer issues than heart attack issues, or am I wrong?
No, both.
Both,
They gave both, you know, the WHI came out in 2002 and gave both estrogen just two
hormone
thumbs,
replacement.
Two thumbs down for, they said it increased the risk of heart attack and it increased the risk of breast cancer, which then they found was not true, that if estrogen was given non-orally or if it was given without the progestin, that it actually decreased the risk of heart attack and decreased the risk of breast cancer.
Right.
So having said that, that's all put down. Now they're saying, estrogen protects women until menopause from heart attacks.
Right.
And women should have estrogen, estradiol, the young woman's estrogen, as they get older to protect them from having heart attacks.
Okay.
It lowers the cholesterol. It decreases inflammation. So both things lower the risk of heart attack. They also have found that men should have some, not a lot, but some estrogen to protect their hearts.
Okay.
So in the same way that it protects women's hearts.
Well, we should always have some estrogen.
Men should always have some estrogen. The fact is that as men, let's talk about men for a minute because it's less complicated. So as men get older, their total testosterone that they make every day drops slowly over time, and their estrogen goes up a lot. And that's where you get estrogen, their estrone causes beer bellies, man boobs, they get weepy, they act more emotional, you know, and this is from too much estrogen. But the estrogen level's going up normally in men, and the testosterone's coming down, and the free testosterone, the part that is, we say free meaning the active part of testosterone that actually does the job, that drastically drops. So when you're old, you have a lot of estrogen that somewhat protects you from heart disease, but certainly not completely because men still have more heart attacks than women. And as they age, and the estrogen is actually bad if it's too high. So you need, it's just like everything else, you need just enough of estrogen, just enough of the testosterone
but there
to be normal.
But there are multiple kinds of estrogen.
Yes.
So we need more of one than the other?
The bad kind of estrogen is called estrone, and it comes from the adrenal gland, and it's made in the fat. Fat makes estrone. Estrone makes fat. So that's the one you don't want.
Which is where you get the belly.
And that's actually the estrogen that when it's made in the fat, that's why being fat is a high risk for breast cancer. It's you have a lot of estrone when you're fat.
Okay.
So estrone then increases your risk of breast cancer if you're obese. So everybody who's obese has more estrone than people who are thin, even as they age. So when we get men who come in to see us, and they're over 50, and they are producing less testosterone, but their free testosterone, the part that is really active, is really low, we find that their estrogen's high.
Okay.
So we need to decrease that estrogen so that we can increase the active testosterone.
So how do you suck estrogen out of somebody's body? It's not like one of those fat suction things that they do.
That would be nice, but we can't do that.
It doesn't work that way.
No, it doesn't. There's an enzyme called aromatase. And aromatase is the enzyme that takes testosterone and makes estrogens out of it. So Arimidex, back to Arimidex, it's also called anastrozole, it actually inhibits that enzyme. So testosterone that makes the estrogens, it's slowed down, so less estrogen, more testosterone. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so you have me on that.
I have you on that.
I take Arimidex. You started me with like one pill three times a week. Now
right.
You have me on one pill one time a week.
Right.
So is it because you've determined that I've got the right balance of estrogen?
Right. So
how do you know? Do I get you?
Yeah, you cry at movies.
Been
so,
to.
Yeah. So we follow our patients usually at least once or twice a year with blood work. So if I put somebody on Arimidex to keep their testosterone high and to help their estrogen to drop, I have to keep an eye on it. I can't just give them that drug and say, see ya. And I have to.
So it works two ways on me.
Yes.
It helps keep my testosterone high.
And it helps
because it blocks the conversion to estrone.
Right.
But by doing that, it also reduces the amount of estrogen. So
right.
It helps keep the balances more where you want them
right.
to be.
Right. Where they were when you were 40, 30.
Many
so
years ago.
that's the environment that I want to recreate because that's the environment in your body that's healthy.
Okay.
But when you were 30 or 40, you didn't have no estrogen. You had some.
Yeah.
And so my goal is follow blood tests and make sure that somebody who's on Arimidex doesn't become without estrogen. They have to just have low estrogen for their age, but normal estrogen for a young man. That's what we're headed. That's what we're trying to produce. That's our goal.
To reestablish the hormone balance that we had when we were younger.
Right. But Arimidex is used in women who have breast cancer, in men who have breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And if they have estrogen dominant or estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, then the Arimidex just gets rid of all of their estrogen that they're making in their fat. They, in general, they're not usually given testosterone. So it gets them down to no estrogen, which then puts them at a higher risk of heart disease. So when cardiologists look at this drug, they go, oh, heart disease, because Arimidex in women who have no estrogen makes it even as low as possible to keep them from getting a recurrence of their breast cancer, but it increases their risk of heart disease.
Of heart disease, exactly.
But if I'm giving Arimidex even to a woman, I'm not wiping out her estrogen. I'm also giving her the good estrogen, estradiol, the young woman's estrogen. I'm giving her just enough for her to be without symptoms, to be in the same range as she was at 30 to 40. And I'm trying to keep that level even.
So are you having to make a choice then, or are you and the woman in consultation mm-hmm. with you having to make a choice, okay, what kind of risk do you want to have? You can have a risk of breast cancer, and we can say it's this much, it's this percentage, whatever, or you can have the risk of heart disease.
Okay,
is it an either or?
No,
is it
not really. It
okay.
isn't. Estradiol doesn't cause heart disease, and I'm giving them, doesn't cause cancer, sorry. Estradiol, young women's estrogen, isn't the estrogen that's causing breast cancer. So I'm giving them some of that.
Okay.
But I'm suppressing the estrone they make out of their testosterone.
So the other type of estrogen, the estrone, you are still suppressing.
I'm still suppressing, but I'm not getting it to zero.
Right.
But no, but what the cardiologists are thinking is, I'm shutting down all their estrogen. I'm not giving them any estrogen, and I'm just giving them testosterone and Arimidex, and therefore that can increase their risk of heart disease, but that's not what I'm doing.
So are you finding that the cardiologists are receptive to your collegial input?
No. Not in general. One in 20, maybe.
Well, it's the same thing that you used to find about neurologists and headaches.
Right, but now...
But you gradually push back the tide and convince people that what you're doing is
beneficial. What testosterone suppresses migraine headaches. So, I mean, not all of them, but the ones that are caused by hormones, yes. And so they're seeing the light. But it's a fight every day against people saying, oh, my God, that's going to cause, I mean, inflaming my patients, telling them I'm putting them at risk when all I'm doing is actually decreasing their risk. Mm-hmm. Because getting old is a risk. And all the things that happen to us, dropping of our good hormones, increasing of our bad hormones, they all make us sick. Mm-hmm. And the longer that goes on, the sicker we get. So replacing our hormones and making the environment more like it was when we were fertile, which is our best years, then it doesn't make us fertile again, by the way, but it gives us the same environment, hormonal environment as we had then. That's where we want to be. No one's having heart attacks at 30. No one's getting, or not many people are getting breast cancer at 30 unless they've been exposed to some terrible chemicals.
I was in my mid-40s, I think, when my first physician who ever put me on testosterone did, and she put me on injections of testosterone cyprinate. Mm-hmm. And I asked her, am I going to have issues with fertility? Mm-hmm. And she said, no, we can't give you enough to make you fertile once you're not fertile anymore. She said, this is about mood stabilization, muscle mass.
Keeping helping your brain healthy.
Yeah. And so I said, okay, fine.
I'll take it.
But that was before I found out about pellets and that the pellet, because with the shots, I could feel myself cycle up or down as I metabolized the shot that I had taken. Mm-hmm. And I had to go through getting the shot couple times a week. Mm-hmm. Now I come to your office and you put pellets in, and it's an on-demand reservoir that's in my body. As my body needs it, it takes it. Mm-hmm. And I only have to do that 2-3 times a year. Mm-hmm. So I don't have to remember to do anything.
Which is great for men, because men aren't used to the regimen of taking a pill. I mean, women get in that regimen when they take birth control pills and you know, the other things that we have to do because we're women. We get in a regimen of following doctor's orders and taking medications. But men are kind of like, they're free and clear of disease.
I'm like, I have people for that.
Yeah.
And they remind me of this and remind me of that.
Yeah, well, you do have people for that.
I do have people for that.
So,
yeah.
But in general, it's harder for men to learn that process of, I have to take these in the morning, and then I have to take these before I go to bed. I mean, even if they're supplements, it's hard to get a guy to do that. Unless he's an engineer. And engineers are very punctual and detail-oriented, and by golly, I love taking care of them because they always take their medicine when they're supposed to. They still don't like shots, though. The pellets are so much better just because they don't increase your cholesterol. They don't
So what you're telling me is that engineers are linear and anal.
Yeah, but I like that.
Okay, well, that's good.
I like that as a physician. That means that they're compliant.
They'll be compliant.
They do what they have to do, and they get better faster.
Yeah.
So if you follow your doctor's directions in general, you'll get better faster.
You might be an engineer.
Yeah. So in any case, I just wanted to make sure that we had our slate clear on this medication so people didn't worry about it.
Right.
Because in the right hands, when it's given with estrogen or when it's given to a degree that it doesn't wipe out all the estrogen, then it's a very safe drug.
Well, but you absolutely believe, and you have scientific evidence and clinical experience to defend the argument, that properly balancing hormones increases our longevity and decreases our risk for all these different kinds of illnesses. Mm-hmm. Doctors who don't know what you know, who haven't studied the hormone balances and have focused or specialized in other areas, may not know that. And so the question becomes your credibility to them.
Mm-hmm.
And to support that credibility, you've written two books. Mm-hmm. You've written one called The Secret Female Hormone and one called Got to Testosterone that are...
Women and men.
One for men and one for women, exactly. But they are seminal works in this mm-hmm. field. As the knowledge in this area is growing, you are getting credit for what you've written, for mm-hmm. the podcasts that you do, and for mm-hmm. the patients that you treat. And doctors in your area are more and more starting to come around and say, well, maybe she has something to say that we ought to listen to.
Mm-hmm. And they're sending their wives to me. Yeah. Or they're coming themselves.
Yeah, actually. Yeah.
But I've taken Arimidex. There's a just as an aside, there's a small portion of the population who makes too much estrone as they get older. It's like a switch turning on. So they hit 39 and all of a sudden they get huge breasts, which you wouldn't think is a problem, except then you have to carry them around every day. Yeah. And then they get belly fat and they gain water weight and their estrone goes crazy. So their testosterone also drops rapidly. So that makes them feel old and terrible. So even though I didn't have ovaries, I made a whole lot of estrone out of my testosterone. So I had to take Arimidex from the very beginning.
Right.
And the doctor that trained me said, Gino Tatera said, when I said, well, what's the deal? You know, he treated me first, then he trained me. And I said, so what's the deal, Gino? You know, I have to buy new bras. And he goes, oh, I forgot you're Italian. I said, yeah, I forgot to teach you that, that you need to take Arimidex to stop the conversion of testosterone into estrone. He said, because that'll happen to 20% of the population. Most of the time they're around the Mediterranean, so Greek, Italian, some of the northern African areas. It's a genetic thing.
Yeah.
So you have to think about that too. And I've done it for 17 years, and I have a completely clean cardiac calcium scan. So, I mean,
which is another thing that you recommend people get now.
Yes.
And tell us.
Cardiac calcium scan is a test that's affordable. You have to pay for it yourself. It's usually $100 to $200. And it's a CT scan, but it's only two pictures. They take two pictures of your heart as it's pumping. And then they look at the blood vessels to see if there's calcium in there. If there's calcium, that means there's plaque. That means that the vessels are getting narrower and are not passing as much blood and oxygen to the heart muscle. So not only does the heart pump blood to your whole body, but it has to pump blood to itself to feed the muscle. And those vessels are the ones that feed the muscle of the heart. And so they're looking at those vessels as an example of your whole body. They look at those, they can see your valves, they can look for any other abnormality like an aortic aneurysm. So they'll give you a lot of information, but instead of just taking a statin because you have high cholesterol, right, which may harm you, we have people get their calcium scan and look, and if their vessels are clean and they're over 50 years old and they have a high cholesterol, doesn't appear to be sticking to the blood vessels, so statins wouldn't help them.
Right.
It's not gonna, and cholesterol is not hurting them. So in any case, that's what we do to make sure somebody has a good heart. And I mean, if you've already had a heart attack, this isn't going to tell you anything.
Yes.
More than a catheterization tells you. But it's a cheap, non-invasive test that can actually tell you if you need a statin or not, or if you have a heart problem or not, or it could be a wake-up call like it has been for some
right.
people where they go, oh my gosh, I'm going to quit eating lard and all kinds of other terrible fats and eating 10 donuts every Saturday. I mean, it's changed their diet and their lifestyle because looking at their heart with all these compromises in the blood vessels, they're a walking heart attack.
So to close this out, we wanted to talk about Arimidex because we wanted to talk about the importance of balancing your hormones, both your testosterone and your estrogen, for men and women.
Mm-hmm.
As we look at the increased risks as we age of cardiac disease, and that will help us fight that off.
Yes.
All right. Thank you for listening.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.